Welcome to the Finance Committee meeting for Monday, May 2nd, 2016. Madam Clerk, would you read item number one, please?
Appointment: Deidre Smith as a member of the Brockton Diversity Commission for a three-year term ending in February 2019. Invited: Deidre Smith.
Good evening, Ms. Smith.
Good evening.
You have anything you want to say?
I'm honored to be here. Questions?
Make a favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion made and seconded for favorable recommendation to the full city council. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended favorably. Thank you for your service, Ms. Smith.
Thank you.
Item number two.
Appointment: Richard Bath to replace Al Amorso as a member of the Council on Aging Board for a three-year term ending in April 2019. Invited: Richard Bath.
Good evening, Mr. Bath.
Good evening, Mr. President.
I'm going to assume you have a statement.
Actually, I have a fire extinguisher that I want you to, so to give us some money for it, the Council on Aging. I know I had left Brockton politics a long time ago, but I've never left Brockton. And so I continue to try to do community service. And when I was asked to serve on the Council on Aging, I jumped at the chance. We need to expand the facility because, you know, Janice Fitzgerald came before you guys before and talked about the growing population of 17,000 plus seniors. And I can say I have some of my contemporaries are sitting on the council, so come down and join the Council on Aging. It doesn't cost anything. And the other thing, too, is that we're trying to raise, we're launching a capital campaign in which we want to raise some money to expand the council out. So, and I was asked to be part of that, and because I have a lot of experience in raising and working on capital campaigns, and I agreed to do it. So I'm very excited to do this.
Thank you.
So, move to make recommend.
Sprechen Sie Deutsch? Go ahead.
Okay.
Recommendation for favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended favorably. Thank you very much for your service, Mr. Bath. Item number three.
Appointment: Robert Graham to replace Betty Goldsmith as a member of the Council on Aging Board for a three-year term ending in April 2019. Invited: Robert Graham.
Good evening, Mr. Graham.
Good evening.
Anything you'd like to say?
Just that I'm excited to have this opportunity to serve on the Council on Aging Board, and I feel I'd like to give back to the community that has served me well. And my two passions going forward is serving the senior citizens and the veterans of the city of Brockton.
Thank you very much.
Favorable recommendation back to full council.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended favorably. Thank you very much for your service, Mr. Graham. Item number four.
Order: transfer of $51,051.08 from the personal services full-time $22,500, personnel services stipend $2,418.68, personal services part-time of $26,000, personal services holiday $132.40, to ordinary maintenance electricity $1,600, ordinary maintenance snow removal $48,301, and ordinary maintenance goods $1,150.08. Invited: Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Bob Malley, Parking Authority Director.
Good evening, Mr. Malley.
Good evening, councilors. Basically, what we're trying to do here is pay the snow plowing bills for the winter.
A little different number from last year, huh?
Yeah, it is. Yeah, a lot different. It's about a third of what we paid last year, and slightly under what the average is for the last five. We came up with about $70,000 in snow removal costs this winter.
Any questions?
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Thank you, Mr. Malley. Item number five.
Order that DPW is authorized to issue one sewer connection to Briarwood Construction, 31 Belmont Street, Southeastern Mass, for the property located at Plot 9 Circle Street. Invited: Lawrence Rowley, DPW Commissioner.
Good evening, Mr. Rowley.
Good evening, councilors. I'm okay with this. I don't have any problems with this hookup.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended favorably. Thank you very much, Mr. Rowley.
You're welcome.
Item, you can stay right there, I guess. Item number six.
Order that pursuant to the Mass General Laws, Chapter 44, Section 53A and 1/2, the city accepts the gift from Nissan 24 of two Arrow Environment Model EVSERS Non-Networked Level 2 Single Head Wall Mount Electric Vehicle Charges for use by the Department of Public Works for the 2015 Nissan Leaf electric vehicles in accordance with the submitted donation agreement, a copy of which is attached hereto. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Lawrence Riley, DPW Commissioner, and Pat Sullivan, Refuge Contract Administrator.
Good evening, Mr. Riley.
Good evening. As it says, these were donated by Nissan 24 for our two new electric cars that we have now.
Recommend favorably.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended favorably.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Riley. Item number 7.
Order that the City Council of the City of Brockton finds that there is a clear need for an urban renewal plan in order to achieve the approved policy objectives in downtown Brockton. That the City Council approves the boundaries of the Downtown Urban Revitalization Plan as depicted in Map 1-A, Boundaries and Topography. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Rob May, Director of Planning and Economic Development, Robert Jenkins, Executive Director of the BRA, Michael Gallerini, Executive Director of the Brockton 21st Corp, Angus Jennings, AICP AG Jennings LLC, Steve Kearney, Stantex Urban Places Group, Claire O'Neill, VP Planning and Development, Mass Development, Jim Walsh, Mass Development, Ian Jacobs, Mass Development, and John Markovitz, Mass Development.
Thank you. Councilors, I just want to mention we have a lot of people invited on this. If you have a specific question for those people, that's great, but just in the interest of not confusing things, let's try not to be redundant on these. Councilor Monahan, you file this.
Yes. Fire away, Mayor.
Okay. So, good evening, councilors, Mr. President, and sharing your concerns about redundancy, if it's okay with you, I'd like to just offer general comments and overview of all three items, 7, 8, 9. They're all related, and I can give my comments at once. And as you said, we have a long list of experts here with us tonight that can answer specific questions that the councilors may have. First of all, it's a pleasure to be here with you tonight. I just would like to share with you just a general overview of these three economic development items in front of you tonight. Talk briefly about each one of the three, how they interrelate, why I think they're critical to the revitalization of downtown Brockton, and also hopefully see if I can clarify some, I think, misconceptions that have arisen over the discussions of the last few weeks. So in items 7, 8, 9, we're looking at an urban revitalization plan, or a URP, the Housing Development Incentive Program, or HDIP, and the District Improvement Financing Plan, or DIF. Before I get into these, I do want to share one quick story with you, because I think it will put a lot of this into perspective. When I first became mayor a little over 2 years ago, one of the very first meetings that I requested and sat for was with Marty Jones, the president and CEO of Mass Development, because I realized that economic development was always going to be one of our top priorities, and I also realized that we need the state as a partner if we're going to get the resources we need to rebuild this city. So there was a whole group of folks from Mass Development and some of the business organizations, and I thought I gave a pretty good presentation to her about some of the ideas I had for the future of Brockton. And she was very clear and very succinct to me, and I've never forgotten this. And she said, Mayor, with all due respect, Brockton is a city that does not have a city planner and does not have a plan. And until you have a plan and a planner, you'll never be taken seriously at the state level. So I think we've made a lot of progress since then. We do have a city planner now in an ordinance sponsored by this council. I think we've got a real good one. And in front of you tonight in items 7, 8, and 9, you have a plan for the revitalization of downtown. These three items, these are the package of tools that allow us to implement the Downtown Action Strategy. That Downtown Action Strategy that you recently approved, and that Downtown Action Strategy that was the result of the collaboration of a lot of members of the community, including several members of the City Council, were directly involved in the development of that strategy.
So looking first at the Urban Revitalization Plan, the URP. The Urban Revitalization Plan is a small district within the district of the downtown. And it gives us, within this small district, the ability to cause the development of catalytic projects, projects that, if developed, will spur further development. And it really gets at one of the underlying strategies in all three of these, and that is to be able to leverage public investment to attract private dollars. The public investment only makes sense if it will bring private dollars and private investment to the downtown. I think there have been some misconceptions with the Urban Revitalization Plan. I think some folks saw that list of all the addresses of properties and thought we're going to run out, and by approving this plan, you're authorizing the purchase of 26 parcels of property. And that's just not the case. The plan does not actually acquire any of the two dozen properties listed. It simply identifies the future targets. Parcels of property within that small district that we have identified as being potential sites for catalytic development. In reality, when this plan is working, what we usually see is by adopting the Urban Revitalization Plan, our first goal is not usually to acquire the properties ourselves, it's to motivate the owners of those properties to participate in redevelopment. But under the URP, the state requires that we identify all potential targets for redevelopment within the district right here at the beginning. So there are no surprises, there are no secrets, everyone knows which properties we're talking about. And there cannot be any changes to that list without City Council approval. So if for some reason, over the process of the next few years, an additional parcel was identified as a potential target for redevelopment, we would be back here in front of the council asking for an amendment to add that parcel to the plan. There's also been a misconception that this is somehow a 20-year contract. Now, I wasn't around for Campanelli Stadium, I wasn't around for the Aquaria deal, but I do understand why councilors may not be crazy about the sounds of a 20-year contract. This is not a contract, it's a game plan. It's a 20-year look into the future of where we think we can go with the revitalization of the downtown and how we're going to get there. But game plans can be changed. It's not carved in stone. And the reality is that property cannot be acquired without City Council approval. Because like just about everything else, the council controls the purse strings. That's why this is a partnership. The council controls the funding. And no funding, no acquisition. It's that simple. Now the question has also been asked to me by several with the URP, why are we transferring 5 or 6 properties to the BRA? Well, let's identify for a minute which properties we're talking about. We're talking about 19 Main Street, 11-15 Frederick Douglass Avenue, the Petronelli Building, 47 West Elm Street, soon to be joined by the Hotel Grayson. These are 5 long-term vacant, non-performing properties. None of them have generated any revenue to the city in years. A couple of them are not in very good condition and deteriorating. We want to get them redeveloped before they become teardowns like the Kresge. But why the BRA? Well, the BRA is the city's instrument to develop property. They have flexibility and expertise. It's their mission. It's even their middle name. They're the Brockton Redevelopment Authority. That's what they do. So that's the proper place to send these properties that have been targeted for redevelopment. And the BRA has some flexibility that it can do some things easier than the city, like assembling parcels. You know, sometimes you want to put 2 or 3 pieces together to bring in one developer to develop those parcels together. I think they can also do a better job than the city of preventing speculation. The last thing we want to do with one of these properties is auction them off to a speculator who buys the piece of property, has no intention to do very little with it other than close it up and maintain it, and wait for us to fix up the rest of the neighborhood so they can then flip it and sell it for more money. That's the last thing we want. You get a few of those, and then your redevelopment plan's in a lot of trouble. So the BRA, again, by overseeing the redevelopment of the properties, can make it far less likely like something like that could ever happen. And I think there's also been a misconception that an urban revitalization plan is a plan that's used to tear buildings down. Well, that's just not correct. Tearing historic buildings down is what happens when you don't have an urban renewal plan. The model of the urban renewal plan is historic restoration. The model, the first goal always, is the historic restoration of the building. And this plan will help facilitate historic restoration deals. However, if we just stand by too long and do nothing, then we watch buildings like the Kresge deteriorate to the point that they have to be torn down. So the urban renewal plan within that small district is essential and critical to getting the downtown redeveloped. Now let me make a couple comments about HDIP, the Housing Development Incentive Program. First, and I know we had an earlier subcommittee meeting this evening, the HDIP proposal here is expanding the existing HDIP that's already been previously approved, and essentially expanding the district at the northern end of the downtown business district. So what is HDIP? HDIP is simply a state tax incentive to private developers to build market rate housing. And it's a program that's only offered by the state in gateway cities. This is a unique opportunity only for gateway cities, because the state recognizes, and we should recognize, that we're not going to get any private development of market rate housing without some assistance making the numbers work, because private development of market rate housing in cities like Brockton in the downtown will not work. The numbers will never add up without tax incentives from the state, and that's why the state created the HDIP. Now, does anyone think that we not need market rate housing? I mean, I've been listening for years for people saying, no low income, no subsidies, we need market rate, we need good people with jobs that have disposable income. And I agree, we do need market rate housing, because in this mixed use model of the 21st century, part of the way that you're going to maintain and expand that vibrant business district on the ground floor is by creating market rate housing above it to create the customers and the foot traffic with the disposable income to support those small businesses. Small businesses don't come to a place that doesn't have any customers. So the HDIP is critically important to a gateway city like Brockton. And we received some additional good news. We were at Robert and Rob and a couple of us were up in Lowell today for the Gateway Cities Leadership Conference. And we received some exciting news. Right now, up at the State House, Governor Baker has filed his economic development package of legislation called Opportunities for All. And we were told today that in the House there will be an amendment proposed to that legislation that would increase the HDIP tax credit from 10% to 25%, making it even more attractive for private developers to invest private capital building market rate housing. And I know we had a little discussion at the subcommittee earlier, but for the benefit of people on television and those who weren't here, during some of the previous conversations of HDIP, the conversation then strayed over into 40R because they're somewhat related. And I know that 40R is not in front of you this evening. That's at the subcommittee that will the expansion of the 40R. Brockton has a 40R district. It was established back in, Councilor Sullivan, you can help me, 2007, I believe. Does that sound about right with your sponsorship? And there is in the ordinance subcommittee a proposal to expand the 40R district at the northern end of the downtown also, essentially to align the 40R in the HDIP. But I think there's been a big misconception around 40R, and that is that the city loses all control over proposed development if it's filed under 40R. And that's just not true. Under 40R, the state regulations require an independent review at the developer's expense. That review is more extensive than what we would typically do at the city level of a proposed development. But when that independent review is completed at the developer's expense, it then comes to the city's planning board for consideration. It doesn't just automatically get adopted, it comes to the planning board. And we hope it comes to the planning board eventually for approval. But however, the planning board certainly may change or deny the plan. So the city has not lost any authority here. The authority has simply shifted from the ZBA to the planning board. And in fact, I believe the 40R actually adds an additional level of scrutiny that that project would not otherwise get. And finally, just a couple comments on the third tool that we need for revitalizing the downtown, and that's the district improvement financing. Now, I know the council has previously approved the district. This measure in front of you tonight is asking you to approve the actual program. And you see in the program, it's an overall menu of the types of projects eligible to be funded under the DIF, the District Improvement Financing Plan. The theory behind this is pretty straightforward with the DIF. Growth pays for growth. We're reinvesting, we're budgeting additional revenues generated by growth within that district back into the district, not taking anything away from any other current resources. And again, there's, I think, this misconception that by adopting the DIF plan, you've given up control of the DIF revenues. Well, that's just not true either. Each year in the budget process, the upcoming year's expenditures for the DIF will be submitted to the council for approval. And each year, the council will choose to approve or not the allocation for economic development and on what it will be spent. So each year, that increment, the additional growth, the revenue from the new growth within the district, is brought forward to the council with a budget and a recommendation as to how it should be reinvested in the district and exactly what it would be reinvested on. However, the council makes the final decision to approve some of it, to approve all of it, or maybe in a really bad year to say, hey, we're laying off police officers this year, we're going to have to grab that money and use it for something else. But the council will have that authority and discretion each and every single year with the DIF. But in order, so again, growth pays for growth. That's the philosophy of the DIF. So as I look at what it takes and as I look at other cities around the Commonwealth that have had success redeveloping their downtowns, we need to attract private investment. But in order to attract private dollars, and in order to attract state investments in projects and infrastructure that we need for the redevelopment of the downtown, we have to put some of our own money in the pot. The city has to have some skin in the game. And this is where it comes from, by allocating this incremental growth out of the DIF back into the district. Because if the city is not willing to invest in infrastructure, and if the city cannot convince the state to invest in infrastructure because we're not participating as a partner, I can assure you that the private investment dollars are never coming. The developers want to see the commitment from the city and the state to bring that private investment in. So as you look at these three tools, these are the same tools that are already being used by cities like Brockton across the state. And I asked, I asked Rob to put together kind of a map for you and a list to show you, and I think you have to get up closer to them. Rob, can we, okay, Mr. President, if we bring that up closer, to see what who some of the other cities are that are already utilizing these tools successfully. We were in Lowell this morning. Lowell's a great example. They've done an unbelievable job redeveloping their downtown. Lowell's a pretty good analogy to Brockton, a manufacturing legacy city looking to reinvent itself and redevelop itself in the 21st century. Some of the other communities you see on that map, Worcester, Chelsea, cities that have really turned around their downtowns. Somerville, I know that's a particular favorite of Rob's, because when you look at that Assembly Square, I was in Assembly Square one day last week. We had our monthly mayor's meeting, was hosted by Mayor Curtatone in Somerville last week, and he hosted it right in the middle of Assembly Square because he wanted to show off to the other mayors from across the state what Somerville has done with Assembly Row and Assembly Square. And it's incredible. And so I actually, while I was there, and I'm going to use my glasses for this, I asked the planning department at Somerville just to give us a list of what were the tools they used. Well, they used the Assembly Square Urban Renewal Plan, Urban Revitalization Plan. We have a downtown Brockton Urban Revitalization Plan in front of you. They used the Assembly Square Planning Study. We have our Downtown Action Strategy Plan, both the plans for revitalization. They, in Somerville, had the Assembly Row DIF program. We've got in front of you here tonight the Brockton DIF program. They used mixed-use development combined with transit-oriented development. And that is exactly the formula that we are looking to use here in downtown Brockton. Mixed-use combined with transit-oriented. We've got the commuter rail station. It's one of the most marketable things we have is a 30-minute trip to the heart of Boston's financial district from downtown Brockton. One of the catalysts for Somerville was the opening of an Orange Line stop in the Assembly Square area. Development, transit-oriented, using a mixed-use model of development. And finally, financing the acquisition of properties through an urban revitalization plan or an urban renewal plan. So these measures that you have in front of you are a proven model, and if you want to take a look at Somerville, you know, not only do we have the plan, not only do we have the tools, but we've got the guy on board that's used those tools successfully someplace else and knows how to apply them here. Also on that map and that list, you'll see New Bedford, Fall River, and Taunton, all using at least a couple of these three tools that you have in front of you. So, councilors, it's time for Brockton to catch up to these communities. We need to have the same opportunity to attract private investment dollars to our downtown. Our problem is not going too fast. It's going too slow. All of these other cities are already way ahead of us utilizing these programs. So I bring you back to my opening comments and my conversation with Marty Jones of Mass Development. We need a planner, we've got them, and we need a plan to be taken seriously, and that's what's in front of you tonight, combined with the Downtown Action Strategy that you've already approved. Those are the tools to implement the plan. And in order for us to succeed here in Brockton, we need sustained vision and commitment. The Downtown Action Strategy that you recently approved, that gives you the vision. Tonight, I'm asking the council to join me in following up that by making the commitment by adopting these three critical tools for the redevelopment of downtown Brockton. And councilors, I'm in front of you here this evening making the commitment to work together with you. so that we can move this plan forward together, so that we can move Brockton forward together. So I respectfully request that the Finance Committee favorably recommend items 7, 8, and 9 on tonight's agenda. I thank you, councilors, for your time and your attention, and we have a long list of experts behind me here who are all available to answer specific questions that you may have. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Councilor Monahan, anything?
No, I'm all set. Let it go.
Councilor Farwell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good afternoon or good evening, Mr. Mayor. Welcome back from vacation. I have a few questions for you, and yes, I'll start with you. And let me say it.
Start with me.
Yeah, that's in a professional way. Let me say that I don't think anyone sitting here is against downtown urban revitalization. We did receive a 111-page document, and frankly, I was a little surprised at the pushback that we just didn't summarily favorably recommend it in one meeting, and I did receive 3 phone calls which kind of questioned, well, what's taking you so long? So I think it's a comprehensive plan. I think the fact that we've taken more time with this speaks well of Mr. May and his staff and the people that put the plan together.
No, and I would agree with you, Councilor, and I appreciate being invited in to speak with you this evening, and I hope my remarks are taken in the spirit of cooperation, wanting to work together, and wanting to vet out this plan so that we can earn the council's approval.
Well, I certainly will not be an impediment to downtown urban revitalization, but I do have some specific questions for you. And whether you were for or against the casino, we took a huge financial hit when the State Gaming Commission ruled against locating a casino here. The amount of money that we would have received over just the host agreement alone, not to mention the other revenues it would have brought in, would have kind of taken us off the financial life support we're on. And I say that not because we're doing anything wrong here, we're just so heavily dependent on local aid from the state and for Chapter 70 and other educational reimbursements.
I agree with you, Council. I think $125 million over the next 10 years would have been transitional for the city. But I think it's important to note, we were working on these downtown redevelopment plans before the casino proposal ever came up, and we've continued to work on them all along. So I agree that we could have really used the revenue. I'm not sure it's completely all over yet. Maybe there'll be another bite at the apple at some point. But I think that it's still critical that we proceed with the revitalization of the downtown. That was always a big part of the game plan, whether a casino developer ever came to Brockton or not.
All right, well, here's my first specific question. And I read the bond rating reports from Standard & Poor's and Moody's. We're all well aware of the fact that we have drained down the reserves. We're well aware of the fact that we have a structural deficit in our annual budgets. I mean, every year I know what you go through to try to make sure that we fund critical services. But if you look at the budget, that's Table 10, it's my page 92 in this report, here are some of the things that bother me. And you mentioned a little while ago, we're not going to go right out and acquire buildings. But by June 30th, 2018, fiscal year 2018, according to this, it appears as though we're going to acquire and sell about $2.7 or $2.8 million worth of property, and that money will go to the BRA. So I guess my first question to you is, are you sure, and your legacy I know is on the line, are you sure we're going to be able to meet the demands for services in our neighborhoods, in our schools, public safety, libraries, if we start carving out revenues that ordinarily would be available for appropriation by the mayor and approval by the council, and putting it into downtown economic development? Because that's one of my major
concerns. Well, I think, fair question. I think, first of all, that's another reason why we'd like to transfer these first 5 or 6 distressed tax title properties that the city currently owns to the BRA, because that's those properties, as the BRA is able to sell them to developers, is going to generate revenue, which the BRA will then be able to reinvest in acquiring additional properties. So you're not going out and buying a ton of properties all at once. you're targeting a couple properties at a time, and you're able to recycle the money. Now, there could certainly be points in time where the planner and the CFO would be in front of you asking for some borrowing ability to purchase properties as part of the overall plan. But I think we are looking to prime the pump with the value of those properties that, quite frankly, are of limited value to the city. They're continuing to deteriorate. They're great targets for redevelopment, and it gives the BRA some property to work with right off the bat. I also think that, you know, in terms of, you've got to look at the revenue from the DIF. Growth brings growth. So we could, in the annual DIF budget, the council might elect to segregate some of the ongoing revenue from the DIF to specifically pay for the cost of acquiring properties under the urban renewal plan. And what I, one thing I really see, councilors, I look at urban renewal plan in other communities, it motivates the owners of the properties to get involved in the redevelopment themselves. I believe that in many of these cases, these properties will be able to be redeveloped with the help of the current owner without the city ever having to acquire them. But that motivation comes from the fact that the property owner realizes that we would have the ability to use eminent domain if we needed to for economic development. And that's a great motivator for that property owner to maybe decide to go right ahead and make their own deal. And I'm telling you right now, I know of at least a couple of those properties on that list that if we adopt this, are going to go forward, I think, in the short run rather than the long run, with partnering or financing or selling to redevelop their properties. And part of their motivation will be the fact that we have this urban renewal plan. So I don't think we have to acquire all the properties. I think we only have to acquire some of the properties, and we do have some mechanisms to do it with. So I'm not saying it might never make sense for us to come in front of you and request some borrowing. I think that's quite likely for one or two projects. But we're certainly not looking at buying up all of these properties, and certainly not overnight.
Okay. Well, and respectfully, is it your representation tonight that we can adopt this plan and this, albeit budget outline, because obviously things will change in the next 10, 15 years, without a detrimental effect on the ability of the city to provide the critical services that are needed by our various departments in our neighborhoods?
Yeah.
For example, I know we need another school. I know the schools have unmet capital mm-hmm. needs. So I guess I'm, am I pinning you down? Yeah, I guess.
No, actually, Council, I'll take you one step further. I'll say we can't afford not to do it.
Okay, so, but you're perfectly comfortable with this as it is outlined?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now, there was some talk earlier about 40 hours.
And again, Councilor, yeah, it's a 20-year game plan subject to annual review with the planner and the CFO sitting down with the council every year, submitting the plan for this year, and the council making the final decision as to whether it makes sense for the city or not. So we're not making a 15 or 20-year commitment tonight. We're adopting a 20-year game plan. Let me, to respond to that question, let me add one more thing. So we're up in Lowell today, and the keynote speaker at lunchtime was Jay Ash, the State Secretary of Housing and Economic Development. And at the end of his remarks, he shared with us his personal story that how much he enjoys driving through Chelsea on his way to work in Boston every day, seeing the market rate housing development that's going on in Chelsea today, several projects, and as he reminded everyone, began with their adoption of their of these plans in their urban renewal project 15 years ago. 15 years ago, creating development today. So it's a long-term tool, but it's subject to annual review.
No, I understand. I'm sure you can see where I'm coming from,
yeah,
because finances
absolutely.
Are everything. And what I don't want to do...
If I were mayor when you were mayor, I would feel the same way that you do.
What I don't want to do is have the council adopt a plan and then have it die 1,000 deaths because every time Mr. May comes in for a zoning change or every time someone comes in for perhaps a borrowing order, we say no, no, no. Because that's a hollow victory for the city. I mean, either we embrace this and we try to implement as much of it as we can, being financially prudent, or quite frankly, then I think we've done the plan a disservice. And that's why I'm looking at some of these and saying, we don't want to neglect the neighborhoods, we don't want to neglect the schools, public safety, we just can't afford to do that. But I feel...
Well, first of all, the money being reinvested from the DIF is the incremental growth. The growth is paying for the growth. If you don't do the plan, you never get the growth. It's mythical money. If you don't get the growth, it doesn't make any difference. When I look at what other cities like Brockton are already doing using these tools, Counselor, and you saw the list of the cities, and there are some great success stories in there, I don't think we can afford the alternative, because the alternative will be twiddling our thumbs while we continue to tear down buildings one at a time, with no hope of attracting any private investment into the downtown, because without these tools, the private investment will not come. The model for a city like Brockton in the 21st century is mixed use. We are committed to a vibrant, active business district on the ground floor. We heard Marty Jones talk a little bit today about how in the TDI districts, of which we're fortunate enough to have one, that their focus in the upcoming year is going to be on developing and supporting small businesses within those districts, which fits right into our plan. So I don't think that we can afford not to do it. And honestly, Counselor, we're behind most other cities like us. I think if you drive through Chelsea, Somerville, Worcester, Holyoke, Lowell, even our neighbors to the south that are very similar to us. New Bedford's way ahead of us right now. Fall River's doing better than us with their downtown right now. I'd even say Taunton is. They're all using these tools. This is the game plan. The model is mixed use. Vibrant business district, commercial use on the ground level, but housing developed above it, because the only way the numbers work is with the housing. And all of these tax credit programs are for the housing, and there's a demand for housing right now.
I don't disagree with that. I will say, though, that I think with respect to the other communities you've mentioned, I'm not sure they have their public safety challenges that we have downtown, and that's something you and I have talked about in person, and that's going to have to be a key component of this plan.
Clean, safe, well-lit, no doubt about it.
I do have a question for Mr. Condon, and I...
Absolutely, Mr. Condon.
Good evening. After all these years, it wouldn't be a night without asking you a question, Mr. Condon, so...
Never would happen. On the money.
I'm sure you've had a chance to take a look at this plan, and I'm sure you've had a chance to take a look at the budget that's proposed. It's always nice following your boss to ask you this question, but in your professional judgment, based on what you know of city finances, both current and projected, are you comfortable that we can make the kinds of commitments that this plan calls for in terms of carving out revenues to go to the BRA and doing some other things without a detrimental effect on the ability to preserve critical city services?
I think you have no choice, as the mayor said, except to make this decision. When the specific investment decisions come before you, I'll make a specific recommendation with respect to the affordability of each one of those in the context of budgets at that time. But I just look at where the city's economic development has taken place in the 25 years I've had this position, and we've all had a great wish for additional investment in downtown, and none of us have seen investment materialize in downtown the way we have wished for. It just won't happen unless the city takes proactive steps. These are the tools that the state has given us to use. When the time comes, for example, earlier you mentioned the properties to be acquired between now and 2018, according to the plan, and I think it was, about $3 million
yes.
worth. Well, it wouldn't be $3 million in 1 year. It would be a borrowing authorization to buy, if you decided to go that direction. 8 votes of the city council would be necessary to do that. I'd look at that at the time. I might have some caveats. I might say, that it, and in fact, I'm almost certain I would say, you can't afford in this city everything that everybody would like to see come our way. But that's also true for Boston. Boston can't afford to spend all of its money on all of the wishes that all of the citizens have. So this would be a prioritization question, but when you look at the most important priorities of the city, I don't object to spending money on school facilities, but over the last 20 years, while Brockton hasn't had a lot of growth economically, the school facilities issue has been pretty fairly dealt with. We've built new schools. We've taken schools that were older and in deteriorating condition, and with state assistance, we've spent millions of dollars renovating them. Don't deny that there's a need for additional work there. There's work needed to be done on the water infrastructure and the sewer infrastructure. Everybody would love to see additional police officers on the street. Everybody would love to see road investments. So all of those are needs. But what I don't see is revenue growth occurring in the city unless we get aggressive in trying to make certain that we're creating an environment for investment to come into this part of the city. Otherwise, I think you're looking at, I think the mayor said it, if you like the Kresge building, stand pat, and we'll see many, many more of those taking place. So I think it's the most important thing we can be doing right now is to try to get ahead of this and begin to get the tools in place that there aren't many tools granted in a Proposition 2.5 environment for the state to property poor communities. That's what we are. We're a property poor community compared to many of the others, but so are some of the other ones that the mayor showed on his little chart there of cities like Brockton, which have got ahead of us a little bit by adopting these kinds of strategies. We need to do it. I don't know whether when the time comes, if there's a $3 million or a $5 million borrowing authorization, I'll be able to say, no worries, go ahead and do it. I don't think I'll say that. But I will say, here's what I think the implications are, and I think the greatest implication is do nothing, because I think we know the future if we do nothing. I hope that answers the question as best I can.
It does. Mr. Chairman, I actually have an amendment to this order that has nothing to do with the plan itself. I don't know whether this would be the appropriate time to ask to have it considered, or do you want to wait until all of the councilors have had a chance to speak?
Why don't we wait until we see if any other councilors have any questions, and then we'll get back to your amendment.
All right. Thank you very much, Mr. Condon.
Thank you. Councilor Ranieri.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I do want to thank the mayor for coming forth this evening and explaining in full detail to just what we had here in front of us, as well as what Mr. May explained to us at our last meeting, which I think was an awful lot to digest and take along and listen to and to try to comprehend what we as a city council thinks is what's in the best interest of the city, as well as what you as you do as mayor. And I think I was one of the councilors that's indicated the concern that I had when I hear 20-year contract, and I think the mayor and I had conversation just this afternoon in regards to this particular issue and not calling it a contract. And as you indicated, you know, you were not here for the 20-year note for the desalination and the whole situation with Aquaria, nor were I. I came the following year when it became a part of the process, and I always said it was sad that the city council back then was more or less forced into giving up their rights to never be able to make a comment, a question, a concern about a contract. We do appropriate funds to run a city. Why would you give your authority? I could still to this day. I don't understand that. And you saw what we just went through just last year and through the course of my presidency with what we were doing to try to bring Aquaria in to try to make ends meet. And what did we do at the end? We ended up doing what we had to do based upon a contract. So that being said, with how you've explained it as a 20-year game plan, makes me feel a little bit more comfortable. I do agree with some of my comments that my good friend and good colleague, Councilor Farrell, has mentioned as well this evening. And I think that people I've even spoken to in the last you know, few days have had great concerns as well. It is time. We do need a plan. I agree with you. We didn't have a city planner for some time. That came under another administration for whatever reason. That transpired. I was here, but there was reasons, I believe. And if you don't have a city planner, you don't have a city plan, you can't move forward. And, you know, I have great concerns, you know, making sure that we're able to move forward and do what we can do to revitalize the downtown. And I agree with you, just as you said, in regards to even where you were today and the comments that were made. You know, things, Rome wasn't built in a day, and I realize that as well. And it could probably take, you know, 10, 11, 12 years before we really see the highlight of, you know, what we're looking to stretch forth this evening for the city. But I also understand as well, again, as Mr. Fowle mentioned, and you and I have already talked as well, that, you know, we still do need another school in this city. We need one on the south end of the city badly. That's the area I represent, and we know we need to do something there. Already discussions to making sure that, you know, one thing I want is the Huntington School stays open for another year or two, realizing that that building's deteriorating. But those are things that, you know, concern me as well, and for what we have to do within our neighborhoods. Makes it hard because you're trying to do everything, space everything out so that everybody receives, and it's not something that can happen overnight, that every piece of partial property in this city receives everything that needs to be, and every neighborhood receives everything, but we do the best that that we can. So, you know, with that being said, I feel somewhat a little bit more comfortable. I think it was the right thought for this council to send it back for further discussion. I mean, a question I do have for you, Mayor, maybe you can, you know, enlighten us somewhat, because I know one of the things that was supposed to be a catalyst for the whole downtown and the whole new revitalization was the Trinity project. And, you know, that came to fruition through seeing phase one. I wasn't too keen somewhat on that whole project when that was before me, because we gave $4 million of city monies to be used for that project. And as one city councilor who used to sit here, isn't here any longer, but former councilor Brophy said, you know, $4 million that we could have used in revitalization or even in infrastructure into our roads, but we gave it to that project. Now we see phase one, but yet, you know, where's phase two? Where's the parking garage? Where's all of that play a role in this? Because that was supposed to be the beginning of. So maybe you can answer that question. But again, just getting back to, I appreciate you know, clarifying what's before us, because I think there is an awful lot here to digest, so hopefully we can move it in the right direction after tonight's meeting. Thank you.
Council, just to respond to a couple of your questions then, where I believe Trinity is right now, I think one of the critical pieces of this redevelopment is to get Trinity Phase 2 developed. And the biggest obstacle to that happening right now is the 20-some-odd thousand square feet of vacant office space in phase one, and also the restaurant space that has not been filled. So until that commercial space can get filled, I'm not sure how they can go forward with phase two. Mm. But I think phase two is one of many pieces to the puzzle. I think it's also important for me, in response to both councilors, to reemphasize how much credibility we've built with the state economic development officials over the last 18 months or so, and how it's all at risk if we don't have this type of plan to go forward. Particularly think about, we got the TDI, the transformative district, that's great. You know that our new TDI fellow is starting soon. A professional planner working strictly on the downtown, provided by Mass Development for 3 years. I mean, that's worth about $250,000 that we would have never had in our budget. But you know, last fall, we received a MassWorks grant of $1.3 million to redo the block of Center Street between Montello and Main. So from the lights at Montello, where Enzo Flats is and where the furniture building is diagonally across the street, that intersection going up one block to Main Street, a complete reconstruction of that one piece of Center Street, plus the full streetscape improvements on the W.B. Mason side of the road, plus a reworking of that intersection to make the traffic flow better there. That'll be going out to bid this year. I'm hoping we can break ground on it before the end of this year, hopefully this fall. Well, that grant that we applied for, that's an investment by the state in that TDI district. If we don't have the TDI district, they never give us that grant. That's $1.3 million. I just cite that as one example when I talked about that in order for us to get investment from the state and investment from the private sector, we've got to put some skin in the game. We've got to have a plan. We've got to be committed to it. or I will assure you that that state interest and that state investment in downtown Brockton will go elsewhere very quickly if we're not in a position to go forward with our plans. They're excited about what we've been working on, and I'm excited about what we've been working on. This is the best hope for the future of the downtown and the future of the city, because I know there's a lot more to Brockton than just the downtown, and Councilor Farwell, I share your concerns about public safety. I don't sleep at night worrying about public safety. So you and I are 100% on the same page on that. But I also know that the future of our city is tied to the future of the downtown. And if we have a failing, crumbling, deteriorating downtown, we're not going to bring families who want to come live here and put their kids in our school system. We're not going to get entrepreneurs to come here. We're not going to get investors to come here. This is critical. This is critical. It really is.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And just as I indicated earlier, I mean, I'm in no way against any type of a plan, because I want to see revitalization for this downtown area. Having lived here for all my entire life, almost 62 years worth, and having been always one that was uptown, downtown, whatever you want to call it, you know, it was one thing that my grandmother did when I was growing up. She took care of my sister and I, and if grandma took you by the hand, you went where grandma told you you were going, uptown or downtown. But you always had something to go to, and I think that, you know, at some point we can hopefully see it rebound. I don't think it'll be rebound the way that it was back in those days. But you know, I am all for some type of a plan. Of course, I would like to see, and I know some people may disagree, but I'm still one that's stuck on wanting to see a two-way traffic plan. And I can understand some people that, you know, do not want to see it that way. But I still think in order for it to work the correct way, we need to see that. But that's something that we can work on. But I just want to again, thank you for putting things in somewhat perspective. Makes me feel a little bit more comfortable with it. And again, I was never against a plan. I wouldn't do that. I just didn't want in any way put the city of Brockton in any type of jeopardy, and be a forefather 20 years from now that made a wrong decision. And knowing that we can still have our say, I think is what's most important. So I appreciate that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Thank
Councilor
you, Mayor.
Burns.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just if you allow me just a little bit of leeway, I won't go too far, but just a little bit. Usually, I'm one of the ones that says no to a lot of things and a lot of kind of good ideas. But this idea, in sitting and talking intimately with the BRA and with Rob May and the Planning Department and several other people that were involved in drafting this plan, and also recruiting some community members to be involved in this, to give their new perspective to this plan, to have a new idea so that we can do something new, I am in 100% support of this. And when we came off the last meeting, coming off the stand here for the last meeting, I got several emails, calls from residents concerned about some of the things that were presented, or some of the things that actually I should probably say that weren't there. And one of the things that I got a lot of comments about are about what do we do about the historic buildings, and you know, about preserving our history. Brockton is very historic. We got a lot of different areas that really hold, you know, pull the heartstrings of several folks, family legacies, all of these things that we have here. And a lot of people, they were very nervous about, well, what happens to that? Is it just going to live in our minds and then eventually die off and, you know, kind of go off into hieroglyphics or history? So Mr. May was kind enough to draft a frequently asked questions document that had some things on there about some of the historic buildings, what will happen, and some of those plans. But it didn't specifically address what would happen to some of the historic sites, and are there protections that we can, I guess, employ? So can you maybe just talk about that to alleviate some of the minds of the residents about that at all? Because I didn't see it in that particular document.
I'll make a quick comment and then allow Mr. May to answer. I couldn't agree with you more, Counselor, about the history being a very important part of this. I think one of the first things we started working on 2 years ago that we're working on now, and we really need this plan to bring forward, is the creation of a historic district in the downtown. And part of my frustration is when I look at some places like Taunton, Fall River, New Bedford, and I look at what they've got for history, New Bedford and Lowell both have national historic parks as part of their downtown. brings some great advantages to it. I'd like to get to that point someday, but we've got some work to do to get there. But when I look at some of those cities and I think about their history and I look at Brockton's history, and I say, we've got a lot more history than they do, particularly history of national significance. So when I look at those cities like some of the ones I described and elsewhere, Providence, Miami, cities that have really revitalized themselves in the last 10 or 15 years, there are a couple of common themes. One is an arts and culture presence in the downtown, and the other is claiming your history as part of your redevelopment. And as long as I'm around, that would be a very strong aspect of the plan. We've got great history. When I talked about some of the buildings, I want to save every single historic building that we can possibly save, and that's the goal behind this. I don't want to tear any more buildings down. And we're already begun to start to do the inventory. We've worked with Senator Warren's office over what we need to get a historic park. Rob has already done some work on the local and state level. So I'll let Rob take it from there.
Okay. Thank you.
Double duty. Map 1I in the urban revitalization plan shows properties that are either A, identified for demolition, which are in red, or properties that we want to see rehabilitated. Mm-hmm. And as you can see from this map, the vast majority of those properties, and I'm getting away from the microphone, are green, are for redevelopment. Now, it should be pointed out that if you were to
Mr. Mayor, why don't you have your assistant bring that around, and you ma'am. Take the microphone, please.
Thank you. Okay, so the vast majority of properties that we've identified downtown are for rehabilitation. And it's true. If you were to go and do a word lookup on the document, on the urban renewal plan, you're not going to find a lot about historic reservation, mm-hmm. historic preservation. Because this is a work plan that is crafted very specifically by state regulations and is the plan that the Redevelopment Authority is responsible for delivering. The action strategy, which is the much larger encompassing document, has a lot of references to historic preservation, including the creation of local historic districts. And so we plan on coming back to you as part of the first year of this to create some local historic districts, which gives us absolute control, not quite absolute, but gives us the control over how those properties are redeveloped. Right now, they may be designated as local historic or as national historic registers, mm-hmm. but that doesn't require any city review of those properties. By creating local historic districts under the state program, we have the authority to regulate those properties, and that is very, very important. We have some beautiful buildings downtown that we want to keep.
Right.
Part of the way of doing that is by using the DIF dollars and using state historic tax credits and national historic tax credits to rehabilitate those buildings. The heritage that we have in this community, from Edison, from the Underground Railroad, to the work that Frederick Douglass did in the community, to some of the great civic groups that have been in our community. These are all things that we need to preserve and honor. And I think that the action strategy calls very strongly on doing that.
Right. And if you look at some of the other cities and even outside of Massachusetts, the mayor mentioned Miami and Providence. If you go outside of Massachusetts, Chicago, Minneapolis, all of these places, the revitalization of their downtowns, their cornerstones have been building on what's already there. And we've not done that great of a job at preserving a lot of our things that we hold dear. They just sit there and they crumble. It's fine to have a building that's, you know, that was the first this, that, or the other thing, but if you can't go in it and it's got a red X on it and it's going to be torn down, if somebody even looks at it, blows a wind blows too hard, then what have you preserved? So I think I may have missed the beginning of that earlier, but I do appreciate you addressing that, and I do hope that the folks at home that were concerned about that, that contacted me particularly, I don't know about my colleagues, but that they did hear that there is a plan, that it's not just going to be just a big, you know, sweep with a wide brush kind of thing and just tear everything down and start all new and then we have nothing. Oh, so no. I do...
It's very strategic. It's the partnership that Robert and right. I have with you right. as the funding source and the mm-hmm. funding, you know, the authorization of the plan. We're working very closely on rehabilitation. I know we have our friends here at Mass Development. They've hired a consultant who is going to be working with us to identify very strategic strategies for some of these properties that we'd like to see rehabilitated, including the property at 1115 Frederick Douglass Avenue, which we've identified as a potential restaurant incubator.
The Grayson?
Not only does that restore, it's across the street from the Hotel Grayson.
Okay.
It not only restores that building historically, but it brings life to it. And is going to bring life to the street. When we throw in the Grayson across the street, there's a an atrium up there that could become an events location. Mm-hmm. It's another historic building that needs preservation. And so this plan does address that.
I've always said that we need to block that street off and cobblestone it up and put vendors there and make it a walkable way.
We saw what happens when it gets closed.
So. I've always said that. Well, yeah, it was it was closed. But okay, but I want to thank you so much for actually working on this and having the foresight for us, because we haven't had that for a long time, and using your skills and your expertise to bring this plan to us that we can take advantage of. And like the mayor said, and Mr. Condon, I think we can afford not to to do this. So I just want to support this particular plan.
I'm going to put this up here just in case the cameras can zoom into that.
I don't think they'll pick that up, but actually any of these, could you make sure you get copies to the auditor's office tomorrow?
Yes, I will have all of these.
Anything that isn't in our package?
And these are all taken out of the plan itself with the exception of the new map that we did of the communities. We will get that to you.
Get a copy so that can be entered into the record and sent to us.
Yes, sir.
Councilor Sullivan. I'm sorry, are you done, Councilor?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Sullivan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First of all, thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you, Mr. May. And I know when we discussed this a few weeks ago, Rob and Mr. Jenkins, but I'd like, and I do thank everybody that's here tonight, invite guests. I'd like someone from Mass to come up and give their insight on this proposal. Someone from Mass Development, if someone could come up. Good evening.
Good evening, Councillor Sullivan. My name is Claire O'Neill. I'm Vice President of Planning and Development with Mass Development. And it's been my great pleasure to work with the Mayor and Rob May and the BRA and everybody in the community working on this particular plan over the past 9 months. It's been a great pleasure. And at Mass Development, one of the key things with the Transformative Development Initiative is that we insist on communities really reaching deep into their populations and it being a very inclusive process. And Councillor Barnes mentioned earlier that she'd been very much involved in working to get more of the community involved in this planning process, and we're absolutely delighted with the level of community participation. I think in the action strategy you could see that I think it was more than 400 responses to an online survey, which is really unprecedented. It really showed the amount of involvement of the community. And obviously we also did a lot of outreach in terms of the September 30th event, where people throughout came and we had a great planning session and discussion session at the gallery over at Enzo Flats. So it's been a great process. In terms of the tools and what you're looking at this evening, Mass Development feels that these are absolutely the right tools that Brockton needs to be considering and putting in place right now. I'm thrilled with the amount of healthy discussion that's going on, because in order for all of you councillors to be behind the plan, you need to discuss it, absolutely. And these are big steps to take, and you know, we congratulate you on looking to take the city to the next step. Are there specific questions?
No, I just, what county are you from?
I grew up in North Yorkshire.
Okay.
But I have lived in Massachusetts for most of my life.
All right. Well, I mean, as a collective body, I thought it was appropriate to hear from you, and I know everybody that came here a few weeks ago was very patient so I don't have any specific questions for you. I just wanted to get your opinion on this. I did have something for Mr. May at this time. Thank you, Ms. O'Neill.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Rob, in terms of some of the discussions we had previously, I concur with Councilor Barnes. You know, there was a lot of constituents that reached out to all of us after the fact, and also some people on different boards here in the city. One question that was brought up is in terms of this future development, this future plan, and the game plan that the mayor, you know, adequately discussed, would be the impact and the capacity of the present piping water sewer system. And if that was taken into account with this projection of buildable units. The other question, that's question number one to you, if that was indeed, and if the Water Commission opined on it at all. The other question would be in terms of the historic component, and I know a resident, really an advocate here, Lynn Smith in the city of Brockton, reached out to all of us relative to contemplating an ordinance relative to historic preservation. So I guess my second question is in terms of the Historic Society or the members of the Historic Commission here in the city of Brockton, if they had any input on that. Those are two important things relative to the constituencies. So if you could just answer those.
Yes, sir. The Brockton Historic Commission has been involved in the planning. You can, if you, in the dedication page, we have a specific thanks to Ernie Danielson, and who is the chair of the commission. We also have worked very closely with Carl Landerholm in the planning process. So historic it is definitely a important part of this plan. And as I remarked earlier, we are working on a local historic district that's going to help preserve some of these buildings and give the city more control over their redevelopment.
Okay. And what about the water?
Water and sewer, we have worked with DPW and Camp Drescher McGee,
yep.
CDM Smith, who is doing consulting work for the city. So we have taken their advice on planning. We have identified and created two line items for sewer and water and stormwater improvements. So I should say three items, excuse me. As projects are identified, when we're looking at doing rebuilding streets, we will look at the existing underground infrastructure, especially if we're going to be doing a full bore reconstruction. We want to make sure that we touch the street once. And so where it is feasible and necessary, we will be working to install infrastructure through DIF funding and through Mass Works. DIF would provide us with the local match for any grants, whether state or Mass Works grants.
Okay.
To take care of that.
Thank you for that. And in terms of the properties that were stated as potentially being conveyed over to the BRA, would that be a simple? And I think Mr. Falwell brought this up, the 21E thoughts of contaminated land. And I know we discussed this with the Enterprise, you know, a few years back with Trinity. I mean, that had to have silver nitrate in the ground. It was a printing establishment for years and years. And we all heard rumors about Kresge for years, potentially having something in the ground there as well. But when we convey these over, if and when we do convey these over to the BRA, would there be as-is condition so that the city wouldn't be on the hook for anything that may come up down the line for environmental concerns?
I would think that if we are conveying property to BRA, we would certainly require that as part of the, you know, certainly to protect the city. Likewise, when this partnership looks at acquiring parcels, and we realize that there was an oversight in the original draft, and in the frequently asked questions that are posted on the city's website, we do propose some very specific language that we want to make sure that before we acquire any parcels, that we do a full ASTM phase one. That's the American Standards Technical MTM. I'm sorry, I don't remember the acronym, but it controls the testing of properties. So a full phase one would be done when we can get access to the property through a negotiated purchase. We would certainly do a Massachusetts contingency plan phase one, which is an even larger phase one analysis that includes some soil testing. Where we don't have access to the property, we'd certainly try to find a way to do testing around the site. I've been able to do, in other communities, we're able to do test wells in the public right-of-way to give us an idea of whether anything is leaching from those properties. In some cases, you know, we find something, and in other cases, you know, most cases, we don't. But then after the property is acquired, we would certainly do the full MCP phase one, and we do reserve our right to go back either through the pro tanto process or through legal remedies to recoup any costs that we've come up with for environmental remediation. Okay. should that property need
Okay. And in terms of, I only have two more questions, Mr. Chair. In terms of some of the, I mean, we're talking about Fall River, New Bedford, Quincy, I mean, Providence. I mean, that's coastal communities, you know. You can even talk about Assembly Square. You have the Mystic River right there, you know. So, I mean, so Brockton is in a separate category, and you really can't, it's not a fair comparison to talk about those municipalities' development relative to Brockton, in my opinion. But with that being said, I think, and we just had the public hearing continued for tomorrow night relative to 40R. And again, Councilor Falwell had brought up at the last meeting, and I just want to get some clarification. This topic that's discussed right now, it's not strictly contingent upon the 40R expansion.
No, it's not.
I just want to make that clear, because a lot of people, I think, believed after that meeting that it indeed was. That they're two separate endeavors.
They are two separate endeavors, especially the HDIP, Housing Development Incentive Program. There are properties currently in Brockton, around Perkins Park, around North Main, North Montello, that are pre-existing properties that could benefit from HDIP, regardless of whether or not we go forward with 40R. They've already been built as mixed-use development. For example, the liquor store at the corner of Warren and Pleasant Street has residential above. This could become a way to revitalize that property through HDIP, to convert that to market rate housing, and to significantly improve that whole corner.
Okay. And I guess the last comment would be relative, and it was discussed a few weeks back, is in regards to an anchor tenant, right? A core development that's going to really be a catalyst, as the mayor said, for development downtown. And I don't know if that is in the works or not in the works, but I think it's something that really strongly needs to be discussed, because you look at people that are investing, like JJ's Cafe, right, investing a lot of money. They don't have to be in Brockton. They choose to be Brockton or Vincente's. But I guess our thought as a legislative body is to try to reap the most reward for the constituents we serve, right? And it's going to come down to trying to provide the services, as Wynn said, and the mayor concurred with. So I guess my humble opinion, again, is we can do all this, but it's going to be all for naught, and I won't be on the council, believe me. As I said, Jack's the only one that will be. Or he might be the mayor. I mean, who knows?
Poor Jack.
Or he might be down on Pennsylvania Avenue. I don't know. But I think if we adopt this, and I do think we should, without a really true anchor tenant, it's going to be for naught. So
to address that, I think we do have anchor tenants. We have current anchor tenants. We have WB Mason, who's made a major investment in our community and is continuing to look to expand. We have the Neighborhood Health Center, which also is looking for more space, and we would like to work with private developers to make sure that this property is taxable this time. And then Vicente's is a huge multi-million-dollar investment in our downtown, and these are the kinds of anchors that we need to continue to support, else they may go someplace else, in addition to attracting new anchors to the community. And part of addressing and finding those new anchors is to be able to control the sites. We look at the site that we've identified as a pharmacy site. There are three different property owners there. And so through the urban renewal process, that allows us, because we've identified it as an acquisition parcel, that allows us to control that site and be able to market that site to an outside body. If we don't have that authority, we have to negotiate and acquire each one of those parcels, or a private developer has to try to acquire each of those parcels, which could take years. Urban renewal and the authority that we have with the BRA will allow us, and more importantly, will allow Robert to control those redevelopment projects.
Yeah, I mean, I guess you and I have a difference of what an anchor tenant is. The district court, or even Joe Angelo's, or the DA's office, or neighborhood health center. In my opinion, that's not an anchor tenant. Vicente's, absolutely. I think we need to attract new businesses here, and of course, maintain the ones that are here as well. But with that being said, I'm hopeful, and thank you for your efforts, and thank you, Mr. Mayor, and thank you, Ms. O'Neill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Razak.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just have one quick question for Mr. May, but before I ask my question, I would like to thank the mayor and Mr. May and Mr. Jenkins for, after the last finance meeting, I got a lot of calls and emails, and so I thank you for answering our questions for us, and we're all in this together. We all want what's best for Brockton, so we're all for development. But my question is, and one of my constituents asked, we've been hearing about the two-way traffic on Main Street for the last few years. Do we have any idea when and if that's going to happen anytime soon?
I think it's more of an if and a when, as opposed to it will happen. This administration certainly supports that. I believe the business community supports that. Like we said in our last hearing, we are making strides towards that. There was a study that was done 2001, maybe? 2008, excuse me, so it wasn't that long ago. It was a schematic study, and it needs to advance. We are working with Old Colony Planning Council right now. We have BSC Engineering under contract to do the transportation model, the traffic model. We are advancing that as we speak, so it is on its way.
Thank you. So if none of my colleagues have any questions, I move to...
Thank you. Councilor Rodriguez.
Thank you, Mr. Robert. No, you can, Mr. May, you can stay there. This is for you.
Robert to answer something.
No, Rob is fine. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I had some other questions too, and it was answered during the mayor's presentation and yours as well. But one of the things that I wanted to kind of leave here and be clear about is that I too heard from even from some city officials that some of us in the council are against downtown redevelopment. And I want to basically leave that here, as clear as I possibly can. No one in their right minds would be against downtown redevelopment. I mean, all you got to do is look at our downtown and see that there's a great need for it. So what we do have, however, is sometimes a lot of questions. And for some odd reason, there's a rush to get things pushed through. And the way it's presented to the council, it's a do or die situation. And to be honest with you, if we had the amount of information that was given to us today, a session ago, I believe that we wouldn't be here answering these questions. Because we tend to, and I'm sure most of my colleagues can appreciate the fact that we are a little, skeptic about a lot of the things that's presented to this body, because we've been through this road before. This isn't our first... It might be my first as a city council, but not as a city resident. Mm-hmm. This isn't the first time that we've had beautiful plans, beautiful drawings, beautiful rendition, and sometimes we have to call special meetings to come in and approve something as quickly as we possibly can to find out that we're letting our residents down because those projects never went anywhere. So I want to make sure that it's left out here for the folks that are, you know, our constituents, for the folks sitting in the room here, that I personally voted against this measure, not because I was against the downtown redevelopment, but it was because I had some questions that weren't really answered. And in the black and white left a little bit too much of areas of interpretation in the sense, things that needed to be clarified.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm glad it was clarified tonight, because again, no one in their right mind would be against getting from what we have right now to what at least it's being proposed or somewhere where we can go in a few years, you know, hopefully with some things. So I just wanted to make sure that, I know there's a tendency sometimes, and I'm going to say this, there's a tendency of those who are well-informed because we take the time to inform them, and some others that we just assume will get the information somewhere, somehow. And I hope that, you know, for future sake and for the future of this community, that we take these measures seriously to include everybody in the process. I know it's been said here that the entire community was involved in this planning process. It wasn't. You know, some of us, meetings were scheduled in times where we couldn't participate. Some 99% of us have full-time jobs that we work beyond the 9-to-5,
mm-hmm.
And beyond the city council. There are 9-to-5 jobs someplace else, so you can't schedule a meeting at 10 o'clock in the morning, expect me to show up to it if I have another job to go to support my family. So a lot of times we tend to, you know, just schedule, and if they can come, fine. If they can't, they can't, and then say they didn't show up. But I hope that as we go forward, and I'm glad that the mayor actually brought that up, that he wants to work with the council and have a relationship with the council, that we take that into consideration in the sense that a lot of us, you know, aren't in the city Monday through Friday from 9-to-5, that we can kind of show up and participate. Because believe it or not, a lot of us have a lot to offer this community, not if not personally, by those folks that we represent in this community. So please take that as a positive criticism, to basically show our willingness to work with you as well and with the city and with the administration of the city as part of city government that we are. But we need to be a little more inclusive in a sense, you know, to make sure that everybody, you know, don't just schedule something, it's, you know, at 3 o'clock on a Friday afternoon and expect us to show up, that those that can actually have the flexibility of showing up will show up, and the rest of us that might have a lot of information to give you will not be able to give you that because we're not present at those discussions. You know, but again, I just wanted to make sure that it was left here. You know, I voted against it. I'm not against the project. I will vote for it because I believe in it, and I believe in this city, and I'll continue to believe in this city. But one of the issues that I actually did have is the fact that, you know, we're asked to push things through in a rush
mm-hmm.
Situation, and in fact, when it's not urgent and in an emergency, that it could kind of wait until we kind of get all our information, all our questions answered before we can move forward.
Thank you.
Thank you for the
time. I appreciate the opportunity to address this and continue to come back. And we continue to improve our communications to the general public, whether it's on our website, through Facebook. We're trying to find other ways to reach other communities that aren't necessarily on the web. You know, the more people we can get involved, the better a product that we have. I agree with you wholeheartedly.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councillor. I believe that's it. Councillor Fowle, you have an amendment.
I do. The clerk has it, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Madam Clerk, could you read the amendment?
No later than June 30th in each even-numbered year beginning in 2018, the City Council shall, 1, review all progress reports including, but not limited to, financial statements with summary of revenues received from all sources and expenditures made, construction completed, projects under active development, or any other related reports as submitted by the Department of Planning and Economic Development, the Brockton Redevelopment Authority, or any city department or state agency. 2, The City Council shall vote affirmatively to continue implementation of the Urban Revitalization Plan as presented or modified. Failure to obtain an affirmative vote shall halt further implementation of the plan pending approval of the City Council and the Mayor.
And Mr. Chairman?
Counselor, first I'll need a second on that.
Second.
On the motion, yeah. On the amendment.
Just very briefly, what I'm looking for is a mechanism by which future city councils and future mayors will take the time 4, 6, 8, 10, 12 years from now to look at what have we spent, what revenues have we received, what have the results been? Have the results been what we expected? Should we tweak the plan through an amendment, which is allowed by mass regulations? But I think it would be irresponsible not to have the mayor and the council every 2 years take a look at exactly what we're doing and make sure that has the community changed? Do we need to do a couple of things differently? We're talking about a lot of money. We're talking about a lot of time and effort. This doesn't affect at all, in my judgment, the fact that we're going to endorse this plan and recommend it to the Department of Housing and Community Development, but it just sets the stage for the primary players in the city, whomever the mayor is and whomever the councilors may be, to make sure that we're on the right track. And it's nothing more than that. I don't know if the council would allow the mayor to comment, but if you have any comments on this, I'd welcome it. That's really what I was looking for, Mr. Mayor.
Yeah, I'll comment philosophically, seeing as I haven't actually had an opportunity to read it, but I think what you're describing is pretty much what we were already pledging to do on an annual basis, that each year, as an example with the DIF, coming in with a budget, making recommendations. I think a lot of the type of review that you're talking about would be taking place during those annual reviews by the council as to whether they're going to allow the expenditure of DIF funds within the district that year, if they're going to authorize purchase of properties, et cetera. I think the council really, by having the purse strings, really retains quite a bit of control over how the plan goes. But I certainly have no objection to, I mean, I think one of my closing comments tonight, council, was that I was here to make the commitment to work together with the council on this. So if this outlines a framework for us to work together on this, then I'm on board.
I mean, I certainly think we'll do some review piecemeal with borrowing orders and land acquisitions and zoning changes, but it just seems to me that a project of this magnitude ought to receive a very concentrated review every 2 years by the council and the mayor, and just make sure that we're where we want to be. We're proceeding down the road that we want to be, and if we need to make an amendment, we make it.
Councilor, I think if you'd like an opportunity every 2 years to tell us what a great job we're doing, I'm willing to cooperate with that.
And I would be pleased to do that.
Councilor Barnes, you had a question on the amendment?
Not really a question. I was just going to actually probably say what the mayor just said. I thought that in the original proposal, the review was yearly, was annual, that the BRA or whomever had to come and even to request any funding from the
Correct.
Additional growth. And so this is actually reducing the amount of reporting time.
Well, I think he's talking about maybe a more comprehensive review on an every 2 year basis, but certainly year to year,
yeah.
Every aspect in there. Each year, the CFO and the planner have to bring forward the budget for the DIF. The council each year has the opportunity to determine how much, if any, gets reinvested back in the district.
Right.
Under the Urban Revitalization Plan, if the city is looking to acquire property, we're going to have to come to the council and get the authorization to do so. I mean, it's our basic checks and balances.
Right.
The council controls the purse strings. So I think there is a lot of annual control, but I think if I understand the spirit of the councilor's amendment, it's to maybe commit to a more comprehensive, overarching look at the combination of all these things together to say, is the strategy doing what we thought it should do, or should we be making some changes? And I think, again, Counselor, I think in my remarks I pledge to work together with the council to move this forward, so I'm certainly willing to work with you.
Actually, Counselor, just so everybody knows, this is strictly on item number 7 and will be attached as number 9 on there, now therefore be it ordered.
Yes, strictly in number 7.
This would be at the end of the, therefore be it ordered. Counselor Monahan, you have a question?
Yes, Mr. Mayor, just on, and I agree with Counselor Fire, that we should be reviewing. The only question I have is where it's a 20-year, look into the future, 20-year plan. If we at any point can cut this plan off, midstream or whatever, how would that affect the developers that have already bought into the plan? Would there be any problem with that? Would there be anything the city would be...
Rob, I might let you handle that, but I mean, any tax incentive plans that are done with the state, whether it's HDIP or the investment of City of Things District Improvement Financing, I mean, those deals are going to already exist. If I understand what, we can't go back in history and undo something that's already been done. I think it might be, I would think it's particularly around the urban renewal plan that the council is looking to see if our investments are paying off the way that we thought they would.
Right, so we don't see any problems at all with this. Mr. May?
I believe, Rob, do you want to comment? I think our intention was to be here every year, so.
Right, well, I understand that, too. I just want to make sure it's not going to, I mean, I'll vote for it. I just want to make sure there's not going to be any backlash if we're into this 5 years down the road and all of a sudden we say, oh, that's it, we're not doing it anymore.
Generally, I think that the markets are looking for some sort of certainty, and that's what the 20-year plan does. However, I don't see a problem with saying that there is an active partnership between the city, the Brockton Urban Redevelopment Authority, and City Council to further affirm our commitment to these programs each year.
Okay, that's fine. That's good with me. Thank you.
Any other questions on the amendment?
2 years, excuse me.
Yeah, no, that's good. Just
any other questions on the amendment? Question is on adoption of the amendment. All those in favor? All those opposed? The amendment is adopted. I'll now entertain a motion on the order.
I will make a motion that we recommend this favorably.
Second.
Question is on adoption of the order as amended. All those in favor? All those opposed? Item 7 is accepted as amended. I believe, Councilors, well, could you read number 8, Madam Clerk?
Order that the City Council of the City of Brockton, acting pursuant to Chapter 40Q of the Massachusetts General Laws, hereby approves the Downtown Brockton District Improvement Financing Program, the program, a development program pursuant to Chapter 40Q of the Massachusetts General Laws, appending the order approved in 2015, establishing the Downtown Brockton District. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Rob May, Director of Planning and Economic Development, Robert Jenkins, Executive Director of the VRA, Michael Gallerini, Executive Director, Brockton Century 21st Corp, Angus Jennings, AICP AG Jennings LLC, Steve Kearney, Stantex Urban Places Group, Claire O'Neill, VP Planning and Development, Mass Development, Jim Walsh, Mass Development, Ian Jenkins, Mass Development, and John Markovitz, Mass Development.
First of all, Councilors, just want to make sure you understand my verbiage on the last item that was recommended favorably back to the full City Council, not accepted as an order. So,
and I move this one favorably.
Second.
Motion made and seconded.
Mr. Chairman, just for
Councilor Sullivan,
for legislative legal purposes, could we make sure that there is a formal vote to refer that back? Because I don't think it was articulated that way. There was a formal vote to accept the amendment, but I don't think there was a formal motion made properly seconded to send it back favorable back to the full council.
Yeah, we'll do it that way. We're on number 8 right now, but we'll correct that just in
Thank
case.
You.
Question now is on recommendation of number 8. Back
on the motion, Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Studensky.
Question for Mr. May.
Yes, sir.
I've heard the talk about two-way traffic. What part of this particular item, 1, 2, or 3, or rather 7, 8, or 9, would that be in the planning stage of?
It is the planning stage of the action strategy that we developed, and the DIF, number 8, what you are voting on now, could provide some of the funding to make that happen.
And is there going to be, within what you've got planned, is there a way for us to make an assessment to stop that before it occurs? Personally, I feel that two-way traffic is not a good public safety item for downtown Brockton. To double the traffic we had when it was implemented the one-way, you can't get across the city now with one-way traffic. So that's my stumbling block. And I'm just asking, how is it that we can bring it to the attention of people?
Because there's going to be state money involved in this process, we will be doing, when we finalize the study, we will be going, we submit that to the Transportation Department, District 5 engineer. They will have a public hearing here in Brockton to take testimony on that plan. If there is sufficient support for that and the community advances it forward, then it becomes part of the TIP, the Transportation Improvement Program. But each year, again, we will be coming back to you as a body to implement any financing for those projects. So there is a review each and every year, and two-way traffic or any transportation or infrastructure improvement would be made at that time.
Thank you, Mr. May. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Any questions on?
Just okay. On the motion.
Councilor Ranieri.
If there was a motion. Was there a motion made?
Yes.
It was on the motion. Just so I have clear in my head, Mr. May, stay standing. You're not done yet.
I'm not done.
Well, we have a motion on the floor. So.
Just so I have him clear in my mind, the 40Q is pretty much the money that Mr. Jenkins and the BRA have to go capture. Is that correct? Is that Holmes?
40Q is the incremental growth that happens in the tax revenue downtown within this district is segregated into a pot, a separate account that we, Jay Condon as CFO and myself, will come forward to you each and every year to say, this is how much we think should be used towards economic development, and this is how much of that amount should be spent on each category. It's up to council then to decide if that is the correct percentage and if those are the correct projects.
So that'll be more or less a part of like the budget process, am I correct?
Sir.
Okay.
Yes.
So the piece where Mr. Jenkins goes to work with VRA goes to work is where, under
number 7.
It was under number 7. Okay. All right. So I just want to be clear in my mind. So that's what
this is right here.
The 40 Qs. Okay. Got it.
Yes.
Understand. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Any other questions on the motion? Motion been made and seconded to recommend item number 8 favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended favorably. Just to make sure we're crossing our T's, Councilor Fowler, would you state on number 7 to recommend favorably.
Yes, move to recommend the amendment favorably.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend item number 7 as amended favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended favorably to the full city council. Madam Clerk, would you read order number 9?
Order that the City of Brockton has been designated as a gateway community by the Commonwealth and that the Commonwealth has implemented the Housing Development Incentive Program, HDIP, to encourage the development of market-rate housing in the gateway communities through state tax credits to qualified development projects. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Rob May, Director of Planning and Economic Development, and Nelson Fernandez, Brockton Redevelopment Authority, Citizens Advisory Committee.
Motion to recommend favorably.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended favorably to the full city council. Thank you very much, everyone. Item number 10.
Resolve, members of the 21st Century Corp come before a committee of this council to update the council on the Rock Stadium and the Conference Center. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Todd Marlin, Senior Vice President, General Manager, Brockton Rocks, Michael Gallerini, Executive Director, Brockton 21st Century Corp, John Marion, Chairperson, Brockton 21st Century Corp, Matthew Osborne, Treasurer, Brockton 21st Century Corp.
Councilors, I did receive communication. Mr. Marion and Mr. Osborne both had previous engagements tonight and couldn't be here. They send their regrets. Councilor Razak.
Thank you. Good evening, Mr. Gallarani. How are you?
I'm okay. Thank you.
I know last time you were here, I believe my colleague had asked for some statements, financial statements, so you did provide us with some information. I don't have a lot of questions, so I'm going to open it up to my colleagues, but thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Councilor Ianneary, you were a co-signee in this.
I don't have a question right at the moment, Mr. Chairman.
Councilors?
I have a question.
Sullivan.
I actually have a question for Mr. Condon. Good evening, Jay. A few weeks ago, I had respectfully requested that this body get copies of a note or a mortgage, and I haven't seen it. I don't know if anybody else has, specific to the stadium. And I don't remember that conversation we had.
I do remember. I'm not the holder of those documents, so you've not received what you requested. Is that
no.
a problem? Let me see what I can do to dig them up and get you copies of them. So what you're looking for is the actual, all the legal documents surrounding the
relative
city's loan
to, this.
To yeah, the,
absolutely.
Yeah, there were UCC filings, there was a mortgage loan securing
yep.
it, and the promissory note, and the loan and security agreement of the documents
that,
you're looking
right.
for. Okay, I think I don't have them all, but I can dig them up for you.
Okay, that would be wonderful.
I'm sorry you didn't get them.
No, thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Lally. Councilor
Lally. A question for Mr. Gallarani. It's coming around to, you know, summer, and that's a lot more outdoor activity and things like that. So are you aware of any increase in you know, the tenants of the stadium and the conference center? Are you aware of any increased effort on their behalf to recruit anything to happen, any business there?
Yes, obviously I've taken the heightened involvement in stadium and Shaw Center activity in the past few months, even before the first meeting with the council. So it's almost a weekly thing. What's new? What can we talk about publicly? Because sometimes some events aren't solidified. But today, Todd Marlin told me that there is a Brazilian rodeo planned for Memorial Day weekend. So that will be in the stadium, obviously. There's two Brazilian concerts planned for June and October, and I believe those are in the Shaw Center, because he did not tell me specifically that was the stadium. And a Haitian concert planned for July 2nd in the stadium. And there's some other big things in the works, but they haven't been, and there's other people, other outside organizations involved, so it's not for me to make those announcements. But there is a strong effort, because keep in mind, they're in it to make money, so they're going to keep pushing in whatever the capacity is to be able to bring the types of events that we'd like to see in the city. Also, MMA fights are going to be at the stadium. That announcement was made last week. And I know they were looking to do some during the other months indoors at the Shaw Center. So there's going to be a regular schedule, I believe, of MMA. It's a constant growth that we're always looking, and I'm always sending him emails or giving him calls saying, have you thought about this? Have you thought about that? So there's a lot of dialogue. And then people are always suggesting to me other ideas, and we kick those ideas around and explore them.
I know we just talked right before.
Right, you and I just
about,
had a
yeah.
conversation about one, yes.
Well, that's good to hear. Thank right. you.
Councilor Farwell.
Mr. Gallarani, would you be willing to work with Mr. Condon? There's one issue that I have unresolved regarding the stadium and the conference center. There apparently was never any formal deed that was drawn up as a result of the plan that Mr. Holmgren did when that structure was originally built. And, you know, to the extent that it ever changes hands, we ought to have a properly recorded
sure.
deed on file. My understanding, and I could be wrong, is that has not been done as yet, so I know I exchanged emails with Mr. Condon a couple of months ago about it, but I'd like to get that resolved.
You know, I've been breaking down all the files and reassembling them. I have not come across one, so yeah. yes, absolutely.
Thank you very much.
Absolutely.
You all set?
Yes.
Thank you. Councilor Barnes.
Yes, actually through the chair to Councilor Azak, she alluded to the fact that there were some financials that were shared with her. I didn't receive it, so.
No, they were sent out to, I believe, everybody.
They were sent out a couple of weeks ago, yeah.
In the big packet?
They were mailed to your home. That's when I, where I got mine.
75 pages.
Oh, that stuff 2 weeks ago? Oh.
So you have.
And just.
Just quite a thick packet. If you don't, we'll get a fresh copy for you.
That was heavily questioned.
We had quite a degree of questions on, yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Councilor Rodriguez.
Hello, Mike. How are you?
All right. I'm doing
thank you,
okay.
Mr. Chairman. Just a quick question, and it's something that we hear often from the community. And I'm just going to ask you point blank and basically, can you tell us what do taxpayers or residents of Brockton actually get from having the Rocks in Brockton and the conference center in Brockton functioning? Because, I mean, we hear that we're paying for their electricity, we're paying for their water. So what are we actually getting from them?
Well, I think there's some offset, you know, with regard to what we pay for, what they pay us back in that rent. And as you know, we had that conversation a month ago about the maintenance. I think what you have to look at when you think about the stadium and the conference center was the original intent. It was to create a vehicle that was different for the city. I think it was Councilman Sullivan that talked about the waterfront in New Bedford and others. We don't have a waterfront. We have to invent things that draw people to the city. That was the idea of the casino that was going to bring in thousands of people every day by their plan. I think the baseball stadium and the conference center should operate in much the same way. Thousands of people every day, probably not. But as a vehicle and as a sense of community pride, that's what you get out of it. If the baseball team's doing well, we all feel good. And other activities, the high school team uses that facility. I bet you there's no team in the league that has a field and a stadium like they have at their disposal. So that's a nice value to add. If you're a second baseman on the high school team, it's great to get up to go to those games. If you're the parent going to watch your son play at those games, the stadium's open to the little leagues to come in and do events. I know the Rocks are doing a program with Good Samaritan where the kids and families are encouraged to make healthy decisions and read. And those kids that meet the certain levels get to go to a Rocks game, their classes get to go. And so there's a lot of community interests that come out when you own places like this.
But what I was asking is not necessarily about the entertainment factor. What I was saying is basically, I mean, we're not paying for Vicente's water bills or light bills, and they're employing citizens at their facility. I'm saying from that standpoint, what are we getting from the folks at Petronelli, not Petronelli Way, Feinberg Way?
They pay their water bill. Now they might be a little behind, but they pay their water bill. Right, I mean, it's not a financial incentive to own, definitely. I mean, I'm going to use what the mayor said. I wasn't here when those were built, so I wasn't here even when this latest lease was negotiated. I trust the intelligence and the thoughtfulness of Joe Casey, who led the negotiation of that lease. And I agree, he did a great job. And it is what it is in that regard. You've got a stadium, and the alternative of having a parcel of land and two facilities that could be dark is far worse than having something that maybe isn't creating a revenue stream for the city. And actually, you know,
I'm not suggesting that we get rid of the stadium or the Shaw Center. I'm just saying, as a taxpayer, that we all are, we're looking for ways to kind of take the load off of us, and this project was brought in as a catalyst to help, you know, the development of the city. I mean, you said we don't have a waterfront, we have the Rock Stadium. But if the Rock Stadium is empty, and there's not too many people going to the games, and it's only available 2-3 months a year, it's not doing what it should be doing in terms of helping the city out. So when you look at, you've got businesses in the community that are struggling, but we're not helping those businesses out by paying their water bills or their light bills. But yet you've got this business that actually technically isn't doing much for the citizenship, and yet we continue to throw resources and time and effort instead of you standing here answering questions about what developments are coming into the community, what things are you doing? You're here answering questions about the Shaw Center and the stadium, you know? We hear some of these other major happenings in other communities that do not have a waterfront and some of the other things, but they're doing pretty well, you know? But somehow, and I think I'm going to go back to what I said earlier today, that there's this perception that we're anti-business, anti-development. But it's just, you know, when you've been kicked around a couple times, you know, it gets to a point where you say, you know what, you've got me a little too many times, so it's time for me to react and protect myself, you know. But it's one of those things that comes up constantly because it sounds good, and what we hear all the time is that, you know, you've got volunteers who are on the board and volunteers who are doing this. We have volunteers throughout the city doing wonderful things in boards all over the place. Most of us sit on boards. You know, but the thing is, we're also not costing taxpayers additional resources and funds. And that's the concern that a lot of us have, and the taxpayers actually have, that they're not getting the benefits that they could either out of something that was basically sold to them as a catalyst for bringing people into the city. It did it back in the days, but now it's not happening anymore. Right. You know, so I think the thinking has to be a little different to do that, because we can't keep doing that.
And I agree with you. And that's why you'll hear me talking a lot about what we're doing with the stadium. And I agree with you that is it the best use of my time? Well, it is my time right now to do whatever it takes to get it right, to get it back to that piece of the puzzle that we all, or the people of the city, thought were great. And even I did. When it was built, I was the economic development director.
I know, but you work for the city. You work for the city of Brockton, not for the Rocks.
But the property.
He gave you his answer.
But the property is owned by the city. At the end of the day, we're the stewards of it. But and we all recognize the fact that it's really the city stadium. But it's our job also to make sure that everything is as good as it should be, and encourage them, just like I encourage any other business. I mean, there's businesses in this city that come and sit with me and just run ideas, and we have very candid conversations about what they're doing. And the Rocks are no different. It's just because it's so visible and it's such a key, important part of the community that we have to be very sensitive to it. But yes, I'm gonna go out and start looking at other stadiums and meeting with community officials and stadium people to see how they operate their small stadiums, like, you know, the scale of what Campanelli Stadium is. It's the same thing I do with downtowns. No matter where I go, you know, Gene will tell you, first thing I do is go and start taking pictures of downtowns. You know, I'm a fanatic about that. I'm going to become a fanatic about stadiums. To go back to, I think Councilor Fowell reminded me of the one day I said, I didn't know anything about stadiums. I didn't when I came, but I'm learning a great deal, and I'm picking up on this. It's a piece of property, no different than an industrial park. You've got to make it work, and that's the goal. And at the end of the day, if it's determined it's not working, I will be very candid about it and say, this is as good as it's going to get. But today, going forward, or you know, when we started really getting aggressive about this a few weeks ago, you're going to see a new strategy, and hopefully everybody agrees that we're doing the right thing. And if not, give us the pushback and where we belong to do the right thing.
Well, I hope so. And thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Ranieri.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I apologize. I was out of the chambers for a few moments, so I was not here to hear the beginning of the presentation. But understanding that from what I did hear from a colleague of mine when I came back in was the topic about concerts at the stadium. And I don't like to be the bearer of always one that brings that up in regards to concerts, but I do want to have a list of any dates and times that these concerts are going to be held, because as I've always said, I have to remind people that there is a neighborhood right by there.
Can I ask you, is it...
Go right ahead.
When they're indoor concerts, is it...
Outdoor concerts.
Just outdoor. Well, you can write, if you would, write down July 2nd. It's a Haitian concert.
Yeah.
At the stadium.
Okay.
The others are planned, I believe, for Shaw's. If that's different, I will let you know.
Okay.
And
inside
the rodeo is Memorial Day weekend. I don't know if that... I'm sure that'll be noisy in terms of cheering, but...
The rodeo is going to be at the stadium?
Yes.
Bad enough when we have it at the fairgrounds, what we have to put up with. Councilor Monahan? okay.
The Brazilian rodeo.
Yeah, so it might be a little different. Doesn't matter, it's a rodeo. okay, my only comment is that, you know, when it does transpire, it does create noise, and it's tough within a neighborhood, as we have to, you know, sort of explain to people that we're trying to do what we can. We do allow entertainment to come in, and they go, I believe you have to go to the license commission to obtain the license in order to do it, if I'm not mistaken. But at this point, I just have great concerns to all the times that, you know, whatever time they're being held, and the fact that I have neighborhoods within that area. So please keep that in mind.
Let me ask you your thoughts on this, and it's just going through my head, so forgive me if it's not feasible at all. I'm assuming the sound is because it's projecting from home plate out, and there's nothing to capture the sound on the far end.
The first time we had a concert, for whatever reason, the stage got set up at the same level as the second floor, which you can't do, because then it has nowhere, it just floats out. You know, and because of that, I even put an ordinance in for sound and decimal ordinance in place because of that situation. So, I don't want to have to call, you know, if for whatever reason that particular ordinance goes under the health department, for whatever reason, that's how it falls suit, I would obviously say, because of hearing ears, whatever. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that's my greatest concern, is I think it's the way it's set. Everyone has to just keep into mind and consideration the fact that there is a neighborhood's neighboring right there, and especially, you know, you say July 2nd, well, you're still two away from 4th of July, but it's a weekend, because 4th of July, I believe, is on a weekend this year. So people do things, and that's what happened a few years ago. They were drowned out by a noise of a concert and never could enjoy their festivities as well. So I'm not opposed, but I'm just saying I want to make sure that we're, you know, doing it a legit way. You and I can talk further and discuss it and have it right
just
here.
Just so that you can remind me of this, I'm going to look into the feasibility of a sound curtain that
whatever
potentially could, you know, like sound clouds for ceilings. There must be some technology that we'll find out.
And it's probably improved that, you know, I go back to...
as Donald Trump will say, and I'll make them pay for it.
Yeah, well, I don't listen to Donald Trump, to be truthful with you, but in any case, you and I can discuss it further, and then we'll make sure it's feasible, okay? Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Razak.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So thank you again for being here tonight, but the whole purpose of this resolve was came up with some of the repairs that the Shaw Center and the stadium needed. So have they started?
Yes.
Where are you?
The sprinkler system, I'm happy to report, we're good to go for the July 2nd opening of the rock season. We're making the assessment about if replacements needed, but the system's been cleaned out. The small leaks that were appearing have been repaired. We're good to go. And following that train of thought about the safety of the stadium, I signed off on the plans that are going through the process with the city to put another gate out in the outfield, so in case there's an emergency, there's another means of egress. So this thoughtful process is going on here, and looking at everything about how we make this the best facility it can be. And I'm doing the strategy about how we're going to move forward. You've seen the priority list. It was included in the packet. Everything that's essential goes to the top of the list, and we'll just keep chipping away as finances allow. It'd be nice if somebody came in and dropped $1 million on us, but it's not going to happen.
When you said leaks, was that the stadium, or were you talking about the Shaw Center?
Stadium. There were leaks in the fire system. Okay. Pipes.
Now, what about the Shaw Center?
Roof. That's on the essential list.
That is on the essential, okay. Because, I mean, safety is very important to all of us. We want to make sure that we don't have any issues.
You don't want to have an event at the Shaw Center and be rained on either. So it's getting ready to move forward.
It's moving forward. And I know that you had mentioned, and some of the other people that were on the board, that you know, you're not in property management, or what's the other one? I think you mentioned that event planning. But do you have you put in people to kind of make it profitable? I mean, I see it as something that can work if we, you know, and I know you're doing your best, but have you brought in somebody to help with the property management or to get some of these things done?
I will figure this out and make it work. In the event planning, you know, as an economic development director in a community, previously in a community that had a lot of events, I do know how to make them come together and work.
Okay.
You know, so that part of it's, you know, addressing concerns about sound, we can figure that out. It's the building itself, a stadium, not so much the Shaw Center, because that's like any other building, but stadium has a unique set of demands. And I'm just, like I say, I'm going to be obsessed with figuring it all out and making it work. And anybody that knows me knows once I get obsessed about it, we'll have a strategy. There'll be more strategies in place than the people on the other end will really care to know about.
Okay. The last part of it is, I know my colleague, Councilor Rodriguez, asked, like, what are we getting back, you know, from the stadium or the Shaw Center? What is the community getting back? And I know what the answer was, and that's fine. But how, I know that you do a lot of hiring at the beginning of the season. I'm not sure there is priority to Brockton.
Can we
ask that for Brockton residents, Brockton students, high school students? I know there's a lot that can find summer jobs there. And even at the Shaw Center, really prioritize bringing in, they bring in when they do events, a lot of staffing. Really let the community, you know, prioritize to people that are residents in the city of Brockton. That could be one step towards kind of getting something in return.
Yeah, I'll look into what the hiring practice has been and suggest that we want to go to a Brockton preference.
Okay,
thank you. For vendors as well as, and it's interesting because I've been trying to stay with Brockton vendors on the repairs, and not always meet that, but
no, and that's understandable, but I think, and same thing with hiring, but just give priority to Brockton residents.
Absolutely, I agree with you.
I think that would be part of trying to...
I do know that they work with Youth Works on some of the young people that go there to work in the summer. So they go through the Youth Works program, and those are typically Brockton kids. So there is that part of it. The rest of it I can't speak to.
Okay. Well, thank you. With that, I move to approve to the full city council.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Thank you.
Thank you very much and good night.
Madam Clerk, would you read item number 11?
Resolve that the city's mayor and solicitor come before the finance committee to provide a status update and to discuss reacquiring the real property located at 226 Main Street, commonly known as the Ganley Building, that was conveyed by the city for nominal consideration to the Commonwealth for purpose of using the property as a college collaborative. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Conan, Chief Financial Officer, Philip Nesrella, City Solicitor.
Councilor Sullivan.
Mr. Chairman, I did speak to Attorney Nesrella, City Solicitor, and I know he sent a letter to you as well. I'm going to make a motion at this time to continue this matter to the next FinCom in the month of May. It's my understanding that it's status quo. There is no change relative to dealing with the state on this matter right now.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to postpone to the next FinCom. All those in favor? Opposed? So recommended. Councilor Sullivan.
Chairman, a moment of personal privilege. I just wanted to remind everybody here in the chamber and those on TV that May 19th, Thursday night, 6:15 to 8:15 at South Middle School Cafeteria, myself, Councilor Barnes, Councilor Rodriguez, and Councilor Farwell, the four of us will be hosting our second citywide concert lodge meeting. Again, May 19th, which is a Thursday night, 6:15, 8:15, South Middle School Caf. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? We're adjourned.